played the waltz of the mangroves to this class right before they came on, but they don't know much other than that that you're a former journalist turned environmentalist turned kind of patriot and restoration guru. So if you don't I'm a huge fan. So look, if you don't mind giving us a little bit of a sense of your background and your biography, and then we can get into the project, but I think people want to hear sort of who you are and how you came to this work.
Okay. We can do that. Oh, you want to start out here?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's jump right in.
Okay. So Charles, as you know, my background, was in journalism. I spent 20 odd years working for newspapers, effectively. I started off initially, I'm a big sports fan. So I started off as a sports reporter in a local newspaper. Eventually, I really enjoyed the work. Journalism is quite an exciting field, and it pulls on a lot of skills, really. Everything is to deadline. Everything has to be checked, double checked, written, and there's a lot of room for creativity in there, so to express yourself. So I really enjoyed it. Ultimately, my background, I mean, what I studied was I did a chemistry degree, which was tortuous but interesting. I followed that up with a master's in information technology. And then I sort of naturally gravitated towards, I had an interest in writing. So that was developed within, we actually launched a newspaper for the Asian diaspora community within the UK. And ultimately, we mimicked the tabloid styles that are very popular here. So we were an outlet for the Asian community, and we had certain views and certain sort of things that needed expressing that we didn't see anywhere else in the mainstream media. So ultimately, I became the editor of that newspaper, and we had quite an expansion. So we picked up a whole other niche titles for the Black community, for the Asian community. So ultimately, we became the ethnic media group. So it's a representation for voices that are not necessarily heard and points of views and opinions that we wanted to express. It was exciting times, and this was in the early 90s. So following that, I got a little bit adventurous, and I thought, look, I need to travel the world. And obviously these kind of skills are transferable. So I moved to Lebanon in Beirut, where I worked for the Daily Star newspaper for a couple of years. Following that, I came back to the UK and worked for a company called News International, which is a Murdoch-owned entity, and I was associate editor there. And then right about 2007, 2008, I moved to Dubai and helped launch a business paper there called Emirates Business 24/7. And that was a very nice experience working in Dubai. And it was during that phase that we first sort of began taking interest in the environment and the negative effects of climate change. Through Emirates Business 24/7, we covered a lot of stories within that, and basically looking at how a whole lot of countries have made a whole lot of commitments to pump huge amounts of money, but no one was seeing any. So we became interested in terms of, okay, look, how does this relate to, say, a country like Pakistan? My wife is originally from Pakistan. So we basically looked at Pakistan. Pakistan at that time had a huge deforestation problem. It was losing forests at an alarming rate. And that's when we first sort of discovered RED and RED Plus. So my wife, her family originally had a sort of small forest holding in Pakistan, in the northern areas. At the time, it was called the NWFP, but then now it's known as KP, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. So initially, we thought, okay, look, we need to do something here. The environment's very important. Pakistan's deforestation problem is really acute. And what can we do? And more importantly, how can we fund it? And what are the mechanisms out there to make this work? Because, various COPs and various events, a lot of money had been promised to tackle these problems, but as far as we could see, none of it was available, none of it was being spent. So my wife, over a period of, I'd say, this is back in 2009 now, over a period of 1 to 2 years, she traveled consistently and met with the local forest department in the Kaiba Pakhtun Khwa area and said, look, we have a forest, we want to do a red project, we need... At the time, I think you needed no objection letters to do these kind of things because they were developing their red strategy. It was very ill-formed. And then we presented an idea and we did a small feasibility study and we showed them, the local government, the benefits of what we're doing and ultimately how we intended to fund it. And I think from the offset, what we... determined, which was quite important, that at the time, everything, all projects around the world were at the infancy stage, and most of the money was being given in terms of grants. And these grants come with, a lot of conditions and effectively handcuffs. But Pakistan needed those funds, particularly within the red, to develop capacity, to understand the whole process, et cetera, et cetera. So the whole idea at the time was these are kind of development aid projects. But we really wanted to bring across to the authorities in Pakistan is we want trade, not aid. We're in a position to do that. Okay, there's carbon markets out there. At the time, the voluntary market was very, very undeveloped and there was no pricing information. But we just had a gut feeling that, look, this is something... that's going to develop. And ultimately, the benefits of an over-the-counter voluntary market is, people will pay you what they want to pay you. So prices will be quoted at $1 a ton, 50 cents a ton, et cetera, et cetera. But we were always confident in the fact that we could develop a project that would have a whole load of co-benefits and any serious offsetter would want to invest in our project and sort of pay a decent price. So we went with the idea, okay, look, we have 38,000 hectares of forest. We want to do a red project. And then through the process, the government became more and more engaged and they ultimately saw the benefits of what red could bring to that province. And so we signed an MOU with them to perhaps explore a wider area in Kaiba Pakhtun Khwa, 250,000 hectares. Once that was secured, then we kind of had something concrete. So then the next phase was, okay, how are we going to raise the money to start begin exploring how to develop this project? And not, fortunately, I was persuasive and we had a number of early stage investors who put some money in. So we got it to the stage where we did a feasibility study. But in parallel with that, what we were running was a whole load of awareness raising workshops in Pakistan. So at these workshops, you'd get foresters from all the different provinces of Pakistan coming. We brought in some experts and we just talked through actually what red is, what Red Plus is, how it works, and potentially how much it would cost and what were the benefits and what were the nuances needed to do that. I mean, we were of the opinion that, look, you guys are taking small grants to develop capacity, but in terms of what you have, you're already way ahead of a lot of countries. But I don't know if you know, you do know that that part of the world was run by the British. And they set up a real sort of comprehensive bureaucratic system and a comprehensive sort of itineraries, comprehensive sort of breakdowns of all the forests within the country. These are all mapped out. So you could go in and look at the records and historically sort of have a look at what was there before and what was how much we'd lost. At the same time, the Sindh government would send their representatives, and then we met them in 2012, and then we had a look at the work they had been doing. So they have this vast Indus Delta, which is served by the River Indus, which, you know, in the 1920s, 1930s, it was one of the most active river deltas globally. But unfortunately, since the 50s, it had been degraded significantly. That, I mean, the main drivers behind that was the upstream sort of activity. So Pakistan built some huge hydroelectric dams up north, and this was stopping the fresh flow of water into the Indus Delta. And further north, there was a lot of sort of runoff irrigation activity. So basically, the delta was starved of fresh water, which we needed. Obviously, mangroves do need a certain amount of fresh water. But at the time, also in the 50s and the 60s, there was a clear felling policy within Sindh. And this was mainly driven by port construction and agriculture. At the time, the land was extremely suitable for red rice cultivation, which requires slightly saline soils. So all these areas in the past, in the 20s, there were lush forests, which have been chronicled in the British archives. But people moved in, converted for agriculture, and started producing red rice. That became a problem post the 1950s when the freshwater supply was cut off and the soil became increasingly saline. We also had sea level rise, which was bringing in more salinity into the water. And we just lost a lot of mangroves, but ultimately the land became impossible to grow rice on. It was abandoned. Mm-hmm. So for a period of 20, 25 years, what you had was just like vast tidal wetlands completely abandoned. And we were seeing no natural regeneration at all. So, I mean, the ecosystem, the delta was effectively dying. And to the credit of the Pakistani government, the provincial Sindh government in the 90s actually made their first serious efforts to sort of look at the delta and see, we need to restore this because this is an important ecosystem. We don't want to lose it. So they started small-scale planting in the 90s, which they carried on through into the 2000s and ultimately became very good at it. There's a lot of trial and error to begin with. We lost eight species originally sort of flourished in the delta, and six of them had gone extinct. So it's only suitable for a species called Abyssinia marina and Cereopsis trigal. Those the two ones that would grow. We then introduced back a plant called Rhizophora, which used to grow in the delta. And over the next sort of 20 years, a mixture of plantations and sort of A&R on degraded areas, we managed to sort of get 128,000 hectares of existing forest. Mm-hmm. So now our project spreads across 350,000 hectares. 128,000 is a conservation project, and the rest is a restoration project, which we do through planting. So initially the project began as a red project. Yeah? So we had a conservation element and we had a restoration element. At the time, and you're probably aware of this as well, Vera and the authorities, we didn't have a great understanding of what a tidal wetland was. So ultimately we had to treat it as a terrestrial forest, which is certainly isn't a terrestrial forest. There's different drivers of deforestation. There's different ways it grows, et cetera, et cetera. But the initial methodology we used to start the project was VM0007, which is a sort of set of modules that have sort of been clumped together to produce as a red project. So 128,000 hectares we began conserving, and then we started plantation program. Today, now that was 2015 when the project kicked off. We signed with the government of Sindh in 2013 an MOU and developed a plan over 2 years. And what we really sort of attracted us to work with the government of Sindh is A, because we began initially as a red project, land tenure, which is very important in this project, is completely clear. It's totally government-owned land. Plus the fantastic experience of the Sindh government in previous years. And they've kind of honed the fact that how they're going to plant, where they're going to plant, and what's successful and what isn't successful. And in that period, it also engaged the communities to do that. So there's about 60 villages that sort of border the Delta, consisting of 42,000 people. And ultimately we worked with them to do the plantations. And now the people planting for us, you know, they generationally have been doing this. They're kind of experts. They're kind of green worker experts. So we began our, naively we thought, look, we'll have the PD and we'll have the credits ready within 2 years. But as you know, these things are incredibly complex and the landscape changes within RED, within all the methodologies as you go along. So we began writing the project documentation 3 years into the project, and it began as a RED project. But then it came pretty clear to me that RED, you know, it's a fantastic, conservation is fantastic, conservation projects are wonderful. But in terms of like, how you account for the greenhouse gas that you sequester or say is very difficult. It's very difficult to do, to sort of say this is additional. It's very difficult to show permanence. It's very difficult to set a forest level emission levels. So all these things were still in the air. RED was being developed, and now it's completely changed. As you know, they've kind of centralized it. So I made the decision, which is probably the best decision I made in about 2014, that, okay, look, we'll continue with the conservation of the forest, but what we'll do now is we'll do a pure restoration project. So we started on an ARR project, and we set ourselves targets of planting, I think it's about 140,000 hectares. You're going to have to check the PD. I may be wrong on that, within 5 years. And as you know, restoration is an expensive activity. I mean, ultimately, we've done 74,000 hectares, which is a huge amount, which is, you know, it's bigger than most projects planned out there. Yeah. But we demonstrated that, okay, look, we can do it, yeah? But what we wanted to do, because we have 42,000 communities, we want them employed, we want them to basically be custodians of these forests in the future, we wanted to scale up our ambitions. And that's where the carbon markets came in. So what we didn't want to do was to fund it via a pre-sale, because commercially, it doesn't really make sense. If you do a pre-sale, you're going to get nothing. Ultimately, all this hard work is going to happen and someone else is going to make the money. You may be able to fund your project, but obviously our governments are the part, are partners of the government of Sindh. So we have, you know, sort of a debt to them in terms of that, to get the best value out of their carbon asset. So we raised more financing, and obviously the government of Sindh are very invested in this, and they allocated some of their budgets to it. And currently we stand at 74,000 hectares. We got validated. Now we're going through verification. And as you're aware, we've basically sold our first issued credits. And now what that does, that means the project will be fully capitalized, and we'll be able to achieve everything we want to do. And it's very ambitious what we want to achieve. Over the next year, there's a whole load of planting. And the only way we could do that is twofold. We need carbon markets, but we need the price to be as high as possible. You know, we don't want to break even. Ultimately, we're trying to build a business here. Mm-hmm. And the whole philosophy behind what we're doing is like, you know, in the past, everything's been grant and development and profit was a sort of, you know, a consideration. But ultimately, if we want to build something lasting, something sustainable, we have to build a business, we have to build an industry, and people have to be able to make a living working, solving problems of the climate problems. And this is the best way to do it, yeah? At the same time, the government wins, they get their best value for their asset, which they can reinvest on other cultural resources and other infrastructure. But, you know, it's been incredibly tough to do that, to say, look, we're not going to take grants, we're not going to take aid, although we could, and we still can. But that's not a model that we set out to do. It's a genuine public-private partnership. And I think it demonstrates to other developers, hopefully out there, that, you know, we can, with access to carbon markets, with access to governments who really understand carbon markets and carbon finance, pull projects off at scale. Mm-hmm. And the other partners we have are the communities, because these things, absolutely no way will work without community engagement. So ultimately, we employ communities to do all the plantations, and then we developed a unique thing called a mangrove stewardship agreement, which have been incredibly successful. Mm-hmm. So what we'll do, we'll have a plantation, and then we'll get some local families and say, look, this is your area to protect for the next 3 years. After 3 years, mangrove forests can sort of look after them. So we employ them on 3-year contracts. They go out and see how the plantations are doing. Mm. They stop any illegal activity, which we can get into what that is a bit later. And they report back that, okay, look, perhaps we need restocking here, and they keep an eye on it. And everywhere we've put in an MSA, the plantations have been wonderfully successful. Mm. Right now, we're in a very fortunate position. We ran a sales process since, I think it was last November we started it. And the interest we had was incredible. It blew me away. We had 64 counterparties who were interested in this project, which kind of leads me to sort of, there's an issue there in terms of like blue carbon is a very popular commodity right now. And everyone wants to get a piece of blue carbon, obviously because of the co-benefits, because of the particular way mangroves sequester carbon and lock it away for centuries, and multiple co-benefits. But right now, we're by far the largest project in the world. Right now, in the market, there is, you know, going into the future, we have to find ways of sort of increasing the supply of mangrove type projects and blue carbon credits into the market. There isn't a lot of sort of mangrove cover out there in the world. And ultimately, restoration projects, you have to have an existing ecosystem to do that. You can't simply, a lot of people assume you can simply go out there and plant mangroves and claim carbon credits, but you can't do that. You can't do that. And I have to explain that to a lot of people in terms of, even a lot of investors are like, okay, look, oh, we got land here, let's plant trees. You know, and that goes against the ethos of what we're trying to do. We're trying to restore a living, breathing delta and bring it back to what it once was. And I think that's important that we have that. Currently within how these things are approached. And then with the communities, to get them fully engaged, like we also have a kind of a unique sort of benefits sharing agreement. It's mainly driven by providing these communities jobs for life. This is a 60-year project, so anyone engaged will get a job for life. The other two things that we're doing for them within our theory of change that we developed, we're trying to improve their well-being, And we're trying to improve their income and lower their costs. Mm-hmm. So in that way, the benefits flow back into the economy rather than, like, you know, handouts are all well and good, but they don't work. You know, we want something sustainable. We want community engagement. Yeah, they have to have some skin in the game, so to speak. And this way, it seems to be working really well for demonstration activities. The main needs of these communities that we found was access to clean water, which they don't have. Even the groundwater within their areas is sort of brackish, so they're having to sort of buy in water very expensively from the cities. We're taking care of that by, we've done two reverse osmosis plants already. We're building them better sanitation facilities because there's a lot of sort of waterborne diseases there. We're also built them a couple of community centers where they can meet. So we've organized every village into a village development committee. And we went through the entire theory of change with them. So it was a sort of an interactive process with them via a thing called an SBIA workshop, where we sat down with them and we said, okay, look, what do you guys need as a priority? Why do you think there's deforestation and how can we tackle it? Within that, we sort of developed a plan and then we did a complete theory of change ultimately. And that guided us in terms of what interventions we need to do on a community level to do that. And what you find, most of the communities there are fishing communities. They're extremely poor. They're indebted. They take loans from loan sharks to get their boats, to get their equipment. And as a result, they're under so much pressure to pay back some of the fishing activities they're doing are environmentally unfriendly. They're using gill nets. They're catching small fry. Another huge problem for them is they don't have cold storage, so they don't get the best price for their fish. They fish off season. They fish in areas where they shouldn't do. And again, just like we have the mangrove stewardship agreements, we're going to develop, once the carbon finance flows in, fishery stewardship agreements, and we're going to have a couple of protected marine areas. And it's work with the fishermen and engage with them. And there's also an element of empowering women in the household to become sort of a part of economic activity. So there's various sort of handicrafts they can do, but they can also do crab farming. I have a small demonstration area where they're doing that. And we're also looking at market gardening with them. And bear in mind, like, you know, we've done these at small scale. We've also built a there's a lot of areas where missing goes back to decreasing the cost of living. People are isolated. So whenever they're sick, they have to travel to the nearest city to get any kind of medical treatment. So what we've done in a couple of really isolated areas, we've put up, there's these containers that we've turned up, especially into dispensaries and GP surgeries. And we've also updated a few medical facilities within the region and provided them with an ambulance. And those are demonstration activities show that these work. And the communities that way become more engaged. They see, okay, look, the ambulance, they have to run, look after the ambulance. The health center, they're part of building that. They built the foundations for us. We put the container in and we put the GP surgery in. And once they've done that, once they've built the foundation, they put their labor, they put their work into it, and they have ownership, yeah? So these facilities are used. What you find in a lot of development projects is you'll build something for someone and no one will use it because no one's really sort of engaged in the process of doing that. And that's a long, long process. I mean, that takes 10, 15 years. But now we're going to take all those activities and now scale them up going into the future. It's 350,000 hectares, the initial project. We've also now starting phase two, hopefully within the next few months. And that's another 250,000 hectares of the Delta to the east. And that's a 100% restoration project. So those were formerly agricultural fields, formerly forests, then formerly red rice fields. And now we're going to start a plantation program there and bring in another 38 villages, which are sort of dependent on that. And all this is absolutely only possible because of carbon finance.
Yeah.
No, the process is very difficult.
Well, I was just going to remark, I guess a couple of reactions. This what a long process, right? I mean, you took on the 2007 and, yeah. and you did, you have not yet issued a credit.
No. And there's no uncertainty, but there's still like, you know, there's still things we're doing there. I mean, a verification process is extremely intense.
Yeah.
Thankfully we're kind of there. We got the sales process sorted, we got everything sorted. But yes, you're looking at like, you know, 14 years of sort of telling everyone.
Yeah, even though you have the enabling conditions with, you know, great partner, you know, in the Sindh government with, you know, high capacity of, you know, their science and their on the ground execution of restoration is good. Even with that kind of background, with the land tenure clear, with, you know, with cooperative local communities, with a, you know, an ecology that's going to respond. Yeah. So even with that, it's a 15-year process to get here. Yeah. The thing that gives me hope, I guess, is that it seems like you've set up a model that can be followed and copied.
Absolutely.
And that's, you know, one, I mean, the scale is the biggest thing on the planet that I've seen in the carbon markets, you know, aside yeah. from jurisdictional red projects, which are, you know, kind of sort of a little bit less meaningful in my mind, given what they are.
I agree.
You know, but the scale is fantastic too. So you spent 15 years putting the groundwork together.
Yeah.
How were you able to keep this going over that period of time? I mean, this is obviously a huge personal commitment for you and your wife.
I think that, I mean, it's down to sort of, it's just very stubborn. I mean, very stubborn. And ultimately, there's a belief in there. And then the process is evolving. Yeah. So it's not like within 15 years and we know what we're doing. Yeah. Every year there's challenge and every challenge is an opportunity. Yeah? And that way you kind of get to learn on how to do these projects. Yeah. So every challenge we face, yeah, you think, okay, no, actually, that's not a challenge. That's an opportunity. This is an evolving science. This is an evolving field. And we can really have meaningful input in how these things move and how these things are made easier. And ultimately, I mean, the biggest pain points are obviously money. You know, how long can you keep going back to people and say, look, we need more money, and they come back to you and say, look, you know, carbon credit sells for $3. What are you doing?
Yeah.
It's never going to work. But I was consistent with every investor, the government, everyone we met that, look, these carbon projects, they're all different. There is not a carbon project. Yet. This is a project which has incredible, unique benefits, yeah, and the right kind of offsetters, yeah, who are really serious about what they're doing and making a difference will understand that this is more than tons per carbon and a serial number which we can trade or retire,
yeah.
And that's what we pushed hard on. And then there's a lot of luck involved. The market came our way. People started thinking, nature-based solutions have to be part of the answer. You know, nature's out there, yeah, it can sequester CO2. And what really simplified it was sequestration projects. People understand that.
Yeah.
You put tons in the ground.
Grab it, get it out of the air. Yeah, let's go.
Yeah. You go to them and say, look, we're saving a forest, so this is how much. They don't understand that. It's not as tangible. Conservation projects are wonderful and needed, but they're not as tangible to the buyer. Really sophisticated buyers understand it. They understand red, they understand jurisdictional red, and they want to be part of that. But there's no framework or structure for that right now. It keeps changing. It's very difficult. And it's a real minefield. I have a whole lot of admiration for companies like Wildlife Works who've made that work, which is fantastic. And partly they were my inspiration. Like I saw what Mike Kaczynski and Wildlife Works were doing. And I think this, I thought, you know, this is brilliant. Yeah. But what we did is, I mean, I'm not trying to boast, but I think it's equally as brilliant because we've started something and we've actually literally created, as you said, a model. And I think this PPP model is excellent. And what we really do need is some, you know, brave sort of not super risk averse VCs or people out there who are willing to invest in a project. I don't like, I mean, pre-sales do work, yeah. But ultimately, you know, you're not going to maximize what you have, and particularly if you're working with like in a developing country, right. You know, they deserve to get the best price for what they do.
Yeah.
So again, that trade not aid model is coming through in Pakistan, and you know, we've had some very good press around this, and obviously you've been involved in what we've done as well. But what really blew me away was the sales process. Even today, Charles, I had about 4 emails saying, oh, we love your project. Can we buy credits? Yeah. That then goes back to what I was saying earlier, because, you know, the supply, there is a supply problem for blue carbon. And if people, and that's a wonderful term, blue carbon, because people understand the ocean and it has, I don't know, it's the, it stirs something in people. This is good, which it is. It's very easily understandable, which makes my life and my job a little bit easier because I've been talking about this for many, many years. And now people are saying, yeah, this is fantastic. And I think where pain points are money, Charles, and pain points are verification, validation,
yeah.
The rules, the regulations. And what you're going to realize is like these methodologies, you know, people, think tanks haven't sat down and thought, okay, there's a methodology that's perfect. It's just a set of CDM modules put together and they said, okay, that's a framework that could work, yeah? So what we're particularly interested in going forward is to sort of refining blue carbon science. Now we're using methodology VM00033, which was the first tidal wetlands methodology developed by the brilliant people, part developed by the brilliant people at Silverstrom. Mm-hmm. Now we work closely with them. And they're still within that, we see issues and problems going forward, which kind of undervalue the asset. I'll just give you an example that within the methodology of soil carbon, we have to assume that 80% of soil carbon is alloctonous, that comes from elsewhere and is deposited. But the whole problem, we have a problem, is we're getting no deposits, yeah? We're getting no carbon coming from anywhere, but still we have to make that deduction. And we have a lot of soil in our carbon. So in our next verification, we'll explore that. And I'm very keen to use technology and networks and the Internet of Things and a whole load of sensors and probes around there to sort of get our MR, our monitoring, reporting, verification system honed. It's been quite a challenge doing the first monitoring report within limited budgets. And, you know, physically we had to, it's a huge area, physically we had to go to all these areas, but there's definitely scope there to sort of refine that and then bring it as a part of a package to someone who's new to these kind of projects. And they can say, okay, look, these are the pain points financially. These are the pain points technical wise. And this is the price. What's your price of carbon? Is it worth doing? Now, the industry has to move to have a price of carbon where it's worth a whole lot of people doing these projects,
right.
And that's why I was adamant from day one that I'm not going to short sell what we have.
What tell me a little bit about the who you were able to get to be, you know, to finance your project. Who is it that, you know, I suspect you've written some checks yourself to keep this.
Yeah, going. Mainly I cleaned my bank account out, and then I had private messages with your friends and associates. Uh-huh. And I would sit with them, explain the project and fund it that way. Ultimately, now we have some investment coming in from corporate entities. We're working with Pollination, but that's recent. Up until now, the whole budget has come from private sector finance and government allocation of certain budgets to this project. That's what it's kept going. I mean, we're very fortunate in that we're working with a government that shared our vision, and they're aligned with what to do. And ultimately, you know, I think what really helped raise the finance is the scale of what we were doing. So once we'd done our first PD document and we looked at, so it's going to sequester 148 million tons, which is not too an insignificant number. And even if the price is, I guess investors thought, even if the price of carbon isn't too much, there's scope in there. So I think scale helps bring the money. And secondly, the government buy-in also helps. So the uncertainty is a little bit lower. And finally, mangroves restoration is expensive, but it's nowhere near as expensive as a conventional ARR project where you have to put your saplings down and look at them for 5 years, and it's labor intensive. Just for example, like our rhizophora plantations are effectively, it's called propagule, it's just a dot which you just place into the ground, so we can work very quickly and cover that area. And in the past, the government of Sin have set sort of 3 world records in terms of how many trees they've planted in a day, which is all nice stuff to talk about. But it just gives you an idea, like, we're fortunate in that the landscape is suitable for plantations at a very rapid rate.
Right.
So all those factors, plus, you know, people invest in businesses and people invest in people as well. Ultimately, you know, you invest in people. And luckily, we have a great team that we've built in Pakistan. We have great partners. So all of those factors sort of helped.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'd advise any sort of potential project developer out there to just consider those factors. Yeah, the most important factor is the cost of carbon, which doesn't mean necessarily, I see a lot of projects going around the world, doesn't, you know, financially they may not be viable in terms of carbon price, unless carbon price is like $80, $90, $100. But there's grants available out there for people to start projects at small scales. And then, you know, if the carbon price does go where people are anticipating it to, and then I think we'll see a lot more nature-based solution projects. And I do really like, I love carbon capture. I love all the other sort of green innovations that happen in business. But to me, when I see something green, I think, oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, right, that's it, right. No, well, that's my background, where I come from. And you know, the nature conservation business, which was what I was in for 20 years at the Nature Conservancy before starting this work and teaching and the like, really focused on that kind of more of the philanthropic or development or aid model, which I you know, I really appreciate the way you have thought this through about, you know, let's make this a permanent business. And it's really interesting to me that it's a business that's essentially based on the currency being the ecology. And it's a sort of a virtuous feedback loop of money into restoration, into, you know, increased health and the like. So it's quite unique. And I think the carbon market may be kind of the unique catalyst for that feedback loop. And the more that the carbon price goes, the more you're able to do and others are able to do, and to create that, essentially that you know, you can start to see that if you do that enough and there's enough of that catalyst happening, you can sort of change that trajectory of carbon, you know, in the atmosphere. So it's really quite interesting to see this and to see that happening, especially after, you know, 70 years of development aid and you know, dozens and hundreds of NGOs doing conservation around the world, but not really seeing, you know, the carbon curve changing much, right? I mean, and the promised development aid that was you know, the $100 billion a year that was promised in Copenhagen, which never showed up, or showed up in loans, which are hopelessly useless. So it's really interesting to see that.
You make a very good point there. I mean, you say it's taken us so many years, but whenever I speak to an investor or anyone, I say, look, even as you speak, the mangroves are earning their money. They're growing every day. They're sequestering carbon. Yeah. So the asset is safe. As long as it's well protected and whatever, however long it takes, it will sequester CO2, and that has a value. So that's quite an easy way to explain to a lot of these sort of VC corporate type people. Plus, they see the CSR benefits that within something like this, which is huge. And they're genuine, and there's a genuine appreciation now with a lot of offsetters. I mean, a lot of them intend to retire them, which is good, but a lot of them will trade them, which is good because that will drive the price of this market. So it'd be beneficial going into the future. So I have no issue. Well, yeah, it'd be good. With our project, it'd be good to strike a balance where we have a lot of these retired, but the ones that are traded, you know, will help drive the market, drive the price up. Right now, ultimately, we are, in terms of blue carbon, we are the market, and we've set a price right now, which we thought long and hard about, and we stuck to that price. But, you know, there's so much interest in blue carbon. Ultimately, I think the future is going to be some kind of derivative when the asset will stay safe and not be retired. So that would drive the price. And I can see it going to blockchain for sort of real transparency as well. So there's a lot of exciting industries, again, which can develop and just move the economy and move the good, talented people into helping people like me develop projects and people around the world to do the same thing. I think it's very exciting times.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, the one thing I've been meaning to talk with you and others about is using that kind of, it's essentially a royalty model from the mineral industry. Why isn't, when you sell a credit, why isn't that, you know, the next time it's sold, why isn't that also returning, you know, a return to you? Should be doable, especially with, you know, blockchain technology and smart contracts. And it just seems, strikes me as that's another way of adding, you know, another virtuous cycle into this loop.
Yeah, it's an interesting point. We've done a model with some of our buyers where they're upside sharing, yeah? So we don't mind sharing the upside, but we don't want to lose it. And we're bound to bring the government to send the most money. So and this is a very good point, because as a project developer, if you sell your credits and you forget about them, 2 years later, they're $100, you're going to look stupid. You're not going to be stupid. You're going to think, oh my God, what did I do? So yeah, you're right. There has to be a mechanism built in where the original project developer benefits up until the point where that credit is retired. I totally agree with that.
We built a few of those mechanisms in, but basically a percentage share on the resale, a profit share on the resale, or that goes either back to the developer or into an escrow fund for the community or whatnot. I just think that we've done it just sort of on the, you know, on the theory that makes our project stronger, right? That helps to reinforce the brand of the project, the quality of the project down the road. But anyway, for another day on that one, I have a couple questions on the sort of the management, right? This you must have some, you kind of adaptive management plan to sort of
absolutely to
show how, you know, do the mangroves need more fresh water? How do you get them more fresh water? Do they, you know, what species are working best? How are you managing around that? And is that, you know, sort of a combination of you and the community and the government or the academic community? How do you manage that plan going forward to make sure that the mangroves are growing, I guess?
Okay, I get a very good question. So currently what we're doing, and the forest department said we're learning by doing. Don't forget, when we went into this project, we had sort of 20 years of experience from the government that said how to manage that process. And the way that process is managed is technically we look at the field, we see how the mangroves are growing, we see how our spacing is working, we see which kind of species mix gives best results. And then we have continual feedback loops from the communities. They're saying, look, over here, there's an issue. So we'll go over there and we'll look at sort of site conditions. And going forward now, we have carbon financing. We're doing greater stratification in terms of, okay, what are the best areas to plant? Because this is a living thing. And as sea level comes in, we get... quite a few high-lying areas which we've planted in the past which don't work. So we will watch where and when the zones become more intertidal. We've experimented with three species which survive. Abyssinia, as I said, is a dominant species that thrives. Rhizophora, again, that thrives, and Cereopsis. But I think at the moment, currently, under these current soil conditions, those are the three species. They're all native species. Those are the ones that we plant. And it's continual. I think every day forest rangers and the forest department go out and have a look at the plantations, see how they're going. And and it's an interesting question. We're not seeing uniform growth initially. We're seeing sort of good growth here, bad growth here. And then we're taking sort of data in terms of, why does Abyssinia grow better here? Why does Rhizophora grow better here? But that in the future will be more. And we've developed a whole set of measures now to sort of deal with that. And what we're more interested in now is we have a growth rate under sort of our current planting regime. For phase two, we need to accelerate that growth rate. Ultimately, you're not going to increase it. A hectare will take X amount of tons, but what you can do is make the interventions where that growth curve is steeper, so we have a more flow of credit, so finances can come in a little bit more early. And then, you know, we have the wildlife department, we have botanists out there, and we also work with the technical experts like Silverstrom. So now we started planting in straight rows only because it looked pretty. But obviously, nature doesn't work in straight rows, although, you know, it's all kind of looking good now. But now we're looking at various strategies and how we can do it sort of in a mosaic pattern, how we can bring the spacing closer, how we can get the mix exactly right in terms of to get the sort of carbon tons that we need to see. We in the PD, we made a whole set of assumptions based on existing forests closer to Karachi, which are quite lush. So the data we had maximum is 20 to 25 years. So we know roughly into 20 to 25 years, the delta kind of evens itself out. You know, this is a living thing. Eh? So it's not like we expect like wheat, we just grow and we'll have equal sort of size plants at the end of it all. But we're learning that, and that's part of the adaptive management that you mentioned. Every year we look what we did, how did it work, how can we do it better? And again, for those things, you need funds, you need money, you need carbon finance.
Yeah. Now you started 2,000 kilometers to the north at the headwaters of the Indus River.
Yeah.
And you've ended up at, you know, cross dams through all sorts of irrigation works, and at the bottom end of the country, and at the outlet into the ocean. What is there an intervention that you need to make upstream to help out the Delta? Are there things that are
So this is part of what we're working on working with the federal government on. So there's a barrage just to the north of our area. It's called the Cawtree Barrage. And there was an agreement put in place a number of years ago for release of fresh water. Now we're not getting that, and that would make all the difference, basically. So part of what we're going to do, we're going to advocate for more fresh water. That will accelerate growth, and that will really bring the Delta back to life. Now, if you, it's quite interesting. You look at the Delta right now. The Delta, normally deltas sink and move. Our Delta doesn't, because no one's extracting groundwater because it's brackish. So it's unique and it's stable. If you go towards the border in India, you'll see some of their delta, and in Bangladesh, their delta's sinking because a lot of fresh water is coming out. At the moment, the only real fresh water supply we have is the runoff from the drainage systems in Karachi, which boosts growth. And then we have seasonal flooding, but every 5 to 10 years we have super floods. And once we have a super flood, we see a marked increase in the way these things grow. So particularly for phase two now, we're looking at doing some channeling of fresh water from the river into particular areas where we look at, say, these are perhaps a little bit high-lying, they need more fresh water. But the main emphasis and the main push will now be to work with the federal government and say, look, we're promised X amount of water, so we need that to be monitored. But you're right, fresh water makes all the difference.
It's interesting, I come from the Colorado River Basin in the U.S., which, drains the Colorado River through very similar kind of country, very dry, very hot country out into the ocean. And the delta in Mexico, in the Colorado River, is completely gone. Very little water ever reaches the delta any longer. And it, used to have a similar profile to what you've described, from the 20s and the British surveys. And so these are very, they're resilient ecosystems, though. You're proving that you can actually, make these things rebound and help nature along in a way that, it's going to take some engineering a little bit, some hydrological change, but
not too much.
Not too much.
I mean, we experimented sort of in the center of the Delta, where we planted stuff where there's a decent water flow, and we were hoping that we'd see ANR. And we see that now. We did some pure rhizophora plantations, and they're now getting invaded by Abyssinia. Yeah. So we're breathing life back into that Delta, and it shows it can be done. And in that particular area, it is wonderful. The water is beautifully clear, and we're seeing the return of a lot of migratory birds. I mean, it's the fourth most important flywheel for birds going down south. And since the project has started, we've seen a lot more birds come in. We've seen fish sizes increase slightly. Pay particular attention to protecting the spawning sites for the fish. So we're patrolling the off-season fishing, particularly to stop that happening. And we're seeing, we're seeing nature tells you if it's improving, you can see it. And just to take a trip down there, you think, okay, no, this is something that would be wonderful if we could restore the entire Delta like that. And it's a 60-year project. So, well, we'd love for you to come, Charles. I'll take you there. You'd really love it. And, it's a 60-year project, so we have time.
Yeah.
If we have the finances, we have the time.
Well, I don't want to take too much more time, but we do have one question from one of our students. And I think I mentioned to you that these are all folks with a little bit like your background, there's science. They're all graduate students. They're PhDs or master's students. So they're scientists. They're policy folks. And so they, and, you know, I'm guessing some of them will end up in journalism and maybe But Eva is asking essentially, what about the local community? Was there resistance at the beginning? And how were you kind of mediated? How did you get people on board? And, you know, what were some of those, like, how do you get those, get folks who pretty traditional, not particularly well-educated probably?
Yeah.
Or, you know, how do you recruit them to engage them in this project? Or does the employment speak for itself?
It's the employment actually that speaks for itself. These people are sort of, I mean, they're isolated in terms of, like, they're away from the major cities, generationally, historically. There's been mass migration from that place, and there's only a few of them left. They have needs that if you can address, they'll engage them. They're very willing to work. Sindh is a slightly different province to the rest of Pakistan, where we're seeing less of sort of those traditions. There's still patriarchal societies, but within that, there's roles for women to play. So women are actively involved in the work we do. It's kind of tribal. So we have one area where there's sort of one sort of tribe dominates. So we deal with them. We say, look, we're going to come in. We're going to plant mangroves and we're going to give you jobs. Yeah. We say to them, luckily, they don't use mangrove. We don't have a huge firewood problem in terms of mangrove wood. Isn't that suitable for firewood? So what we allow them to do now is say, okay, look, we'll take you can take the driftwood that you see every now and then, and we monitor that. They use that some of that for firewood. But their main buy-in is that, look, we'll do what we can. We'll work with you. And they appreciate the fact that we're not this big company coming in from somewhere else and we're doing a whole load of stuff that is for them, yeah? The whole premise, and this is where the CCB standard is very good, even though it's the most complicated document that you'll ever go through. The SBI workshops are really good. So what we do, we say, look, we're coming in here, we're going to do a project. Firstly, we want your free performed consent. We want to do that. It's government land. You have customary rights to it. You're not going to lose those customary rights. But here's an opportunity for you guys to get jobs for the entire family, and to change your mindset to say, look, these mangroves are valuable to you. Yeah, if they're there and if they're standing, then you'll benefit. Yeah. And luckily, it's been smooth. Obviously, the government, this is like a 20-year process to get where we are now. But that was done with very little funding. Like, if you'd ask me, like, could you do that today? And I'd say, yes, if the carbon financing was there. You go out there, you organize them, you talk to them, you say, what do you need? What do you want? What are your priorities? And you put those measures in place that address that, and then you get the buy-in. Yeah. The main particular problem we have now in any sort of driver of deforestation would be camel grazing. And that's not necessarily, they can go into the forest and they can prune the trees, which is actually good for taller mangroves. But what in the past had hampered, they'd sort of walk through fresh plantations and trample them, and you'd lose them. That's where those mangrove stewardship agreements come in. So they see there's like multiple sources for them to earn a living and improve their health. And if they're seeing improved health, there's a lot of stunted growth there. There's a lot of problem with waterborne diseases. And a lot of these people in the past were drinking brackish water.
Yeah.
So it's just going to them and saying, look, you're genuine partners, yeah? We're not here to dictate to you, am I going to do this? Am I going to build all these things for you? They're not going to be engaged that way. The only way they're going to be engaged is if they're involved in the process. Hmm. And they're very much custodians. I mean, ultimately, we're handing it over to them. And this is communicated to them.
Yeah.
So that's the way we sort of got them fully engaged.
You've kind of created a government where there wasn't much government, or at least some structure.
Decentralization, really. It's just like you guys are very much, you know, we rely on them. They rely on us and we rely on them. It's a very good relationship. There's not to say there's not conflicts within the particular sort of clans and tribes, but then we have good conflict resolution measures. We build one anyway, community center for them. They come and, you know, the main complaint is, look, oh, there's a mobile hospital there, we need one there. There's water there, we need one there. But we tell them that, okay, look, you know, that will come when the carbon finance comes. When the carbon finance comes is if you look after the mangroves and if you care for the mangroves, then these things. And they can see it now. And the more they see it, the more they engage they'll get. That's the theory of change. But obviously, you know, we adapt throughout. And if something isn't working, we'll abandon it and we'll try something else. But luckily, you know, things have been smooth.
Yeah. Well, congratulations again. And, you know, I know, you know, my partners and I were so excited to be able to, you know, participate in helping to finance some of this. And
it's fantastic you guys on board. And, you know, we should work together more on this. You know, it's really exciting because in partnership with you and the way you come in, we're creating a model here that, you know, should be shared and used elsewhere.
Well, you've done all the hard work, and we just we're just happy to participate.
Money talks at the end of the day. That's unfortunately the way of the world.
That's true. That's true. No, well, look, hey, I don't want to take up your entire afternoon. I really appreciate your time, and I know the students do too. It's just so good to hear.
Students on?
Yeah. Everybody's on.
Oh, hello. Hello, bright young minds.
Yeah, there we go.
Nice to speak to you all. Thank you for having me. And Charles, if you ever need me back again, then I'm happy to jump on anything.
Thank you so much, Nadeem. And I do hope to meet you in person and get out on the land with you. It's always a different experience that way. So,
no, that'd be great.
Totally appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, everyone.